So the discussion that I have is goal number two of the SDGs. I will also quickly say, I don't know if you saw any of the International Week promotional activities, but I have this amazing SDG pin. Go to Twitter, you will see it on my lapel, but for some reason I did not bring it today, which is very disturbing. So I chose this particular topic. Clearly, zero hunger is all-encompassing. We think about food security as that, the opportunity to have access to available food that's safe, that's nutritious. But I'm going to try to just qualify the experiences that I've had to try to maybe explain to you why I'm taking the approach that I am taking in these 17 minutes. And I'm just going to hit five areas that I would kind of like you to think about as we go forward. So we're just going to talk about specifically Africa, because that's the experience that I've had. I've lived in various parts of Africa for about 10 years. And just to maybe get you to think a little bit about the kinds of experiences that I will describe that I've had over that period of time. This is just to remind me to tell you that I have to believe, and I'm sure that all of my colleagues that are doing these presentations, these goals do not stand alone. They are obviously not isolated or somehow ring-fenced. Even though I'm talking about zero hunger, you will hear me talking about water, about gender, about education, about all of those elements of the Sustainable Development Goals that clearly have to fit together if we really are going to move towards the idea of zero hunger. So let's just lay the context a little bit. The International Institute of Tropical Agriculture is just one of 15 centers around the world. That map on the upper right-hand corner there just shows some of those spots. Not important for you to know where they all are, but IITA is specifically started by the Ford and Rockefeller Foundations in the early 1970s to think about this idea about zero hunger, certainly on the continent of Africa. It's already been covered, but I would just say I first got to sub-Saharan Africa when I was 20 years old. I taught as a volunteer teacher in the country of Cameroon. Cameroon is this remarkable place, a bilingual country, a remarkable set of agroecologies and other sorts of opportunities where I really got interested in agricultural development and the opportunities for agriculture and food. I was there as a postdoc working on a particular grain legume, a bean that is indigenous to that part of the world that's very important in the diets of West Africa, something called cowpea. It's a grain legume, a bean that you'll see. Maybe you might know it by black-eyed pea. I worked there as a plant breeder, worked there across a number of countries, just again getting a sense of these very elegant systems of production. And very much enjoyed the experience of working across a whole array of countries with a wide range of people. So that just gives you a sense of my background. So I guess you have to figure out whether the opinions that I express make sense based on that kind of an experience, leading up all the way now to being a trustee of IITA, where it's so active in a whole array of everything from very basic science all the way through to working with entrepreneurs to try to increase the not only the productivity, but the profitability of people involved in agriculture and food. So let's just set the scene a little bit. This is Kofi Annan speaking, obviously Secretary General for a period of time within the United Nations. I will read it for you. If we get agriculture right in Africa, where most of the people now are working in that sector, not only would it help boost development, but we will be secure in terms of food and nutrition, and then be able to move on to other areas. So you're going to start to see a theme here. Aliko Dangote, the wealthiest man in Africa, has a wide array of investments across the continent, starting now to get very involved in investment in agriculture, in food sector opportunities. This happens to be a recent investment in Nigeria, but also very involved in other parts of the continent. This is an entrepreneur, this is a businessman, somebody that sees that there's a real opportunity in the agriculture and food sectors. The person that is pictured there in the white hat is a person named Norman Borlaug. Norman Borlaug was a plant breeder that worked very actively in what you would know as the Green Revolution. In that particular quote, he's talking about the fact that food is the moral right of every individual. And Dr. Borlaug, even though he worked in Mexico and in South Asia for a number of years, at the very end of his life, he got very involved in working in Africa. I had the chance to meet him on a couple of occasions. The last time I met him, I think he was 89 years old, still working with national governments and thinking about how it would be possible to bring interesting new technologies, interesting new approaches to ensure that there would be a reduction in hunger and increasing opportunities for agriculture and food in the continent of Africa. And I guess the last scene setting that I would do is around Bill and Melinda Gates. The Gates Foundation has been extremely involved in agricultural development in many places in the world. They have been great partners with IITA and many of the other organizations that I've worked for. Melinda and I believe that helping the poorest smallholder farmers grow more crops and get them to market is the world's single most powerful lever for reducing hunger and poverty. So this is somebody that perhaps others would think about as a tech guru or somebody that is only thinking about growing Microsoft and all of its other activities. But Bill Gates was very much and continues to be, along with Melinda and their entire foundation, very focused on the possibilities of how agriculture can really change the scene as far as approaching zero hunger, certainly in the continent of Africa. That picture is Bill Gates talking at the World Food Prize just a couple of weeks after Norman Borlaug had passed away. If you're at all involved in agriculture or food, I would urge you to Google that World Food Prize speech that Bill Gates gave in 2009, because in about two or three pages, he absolutely crystallizes what I would say many of us think about when we get involved in using new ideas, new technologies to have agriculture and food as an engine of economic development. So let's just go to those five areas that I want you to think about. I'm a very optimistic person and I see all kinds of amazing things happening on the continent of Africa. Clearly there are a serious number of challenges. You've all seen what's been the most recent thing you've seen about agricultural problems in East Africa on the news this last one or two weeks shouted out? Locusts. You've all seen those horrendous pictures. Things like fall armyworm. We deal in biological systems. There are lots of problems. But I think what I'm also going to try to leave with you is that there are remarkable opportunities and a very positive situation when it comes to agriculture and food. And the first one I would say is in leadership. The African Union has been very involved in developing very comprehensive thinking around how agriculture needs to be cultivated. The images that you see before you are African Union documents, the Comprehensive African Agricultural Development Plan, the New Partnership for African Development, NEPAD, has been very involved. The picture is from Malabo, from Equatorial Guinea. It's actually reaffirming something that heads of state determined in 2003, something called the Maputo Declaration, where countries committed to spending 10% of their government resources in developing agriculture. And in Malabo in 2014, they actually reinforced that. Some countries got very close to that goal, others did not. But I think it's important to understand that the African Union, that leaders within Africa, have really doubled down on the idea of the potential of agriculture and food and things that they can do to realize that goal of zero hunger. So leadership is the first. Technology, the pictures that I'm showing you are here are from IITA. I'm going to characterize things in sort of three buckets for the kinds of new technologies or other new ideas, not new ideas, but things that might be able to change the way that we address zero hunger. And in that first bucket, I'm going to think about kind of decreasing the growth in the amount of food that we have to produce. Can somebody think of something that we could do across the globe? This is not only for a particular jurisdiction, so that we actually need to produce less food. What could we do? Yes. Oh, not a plant, ladies and gentlemen. Let the record show. So to decrease food, I forget what you said, waste, I think. So loss and waste. So my experience in developing technologies in sub-Saharan Africa was very much about decreasing loss from the field to granaries. But what are our biggest issues here in Canada? Where does our biggest amount of food waste and loss occur? Is it in the field? Is it in our with our farms across this province? Where do we lose everything? Shout it out, I can't hear. At home, in restaurants. So even as we sort of think about the ways that we can decrease the amount of food that we need to produce, that gives us some real options. All kinds of other things that we need to think about. Changing our diet, looking at other ways that we actually, there's obviously in places like Europe, even in America, there are lots of crops that are used for biofuels and those sorts of things. We could actually shrink down the amount of food that we need to do. I'm trained and has worked in West Africa as a plant breeder. So obviously we're thinking about increasing the productivity of crops without increasing the land that we have to grow that food. And it really seems that there are technologies available there. And we're also thinking about all of the ways that we can decrease GHGs. Certainly there are many activities, not only in Africa, but other parts of the world, to think about bringing down GHGs. So suffice it to say, not only with leadership, but the idea of all forms of technology that can be brought to bear on this particular SDG. I think it was also important just to remind people about the remarkable ways that youth, especially in my experience in Africa, are being drawn back into agriculture and food. The picture that's going to show up happens to be an IITA program, but it's covering 7,000 young people across 11 countries and really helping them to develop the idea of SMEs around aquaculture businesses, around food processing businesses. This is true of places like Nigeria. We're also active in places like South Sudan, where there are lots of complications. We know that there's a real amount of pressure on young people to find jobs, to be able, even after degrees, to find employment. And there seems to be this growing interest in youth to get involved in the agriculture and food sectors. The fourth one that I would say, just in more general, I'm not sure that it exactly addresses the idea of zero hunger. Africa seems to be on everybody's mind when it comes to business opportunities. The chart on your left is an economist chart that shows huge amounts of increases in trade with Africa and a whole array of other groups across the world. The right-hand side colors, you can see the message there is increasing amounts of foreign direct investment. So groups are starting to invest in Africa. Certainly there are significant elements of food and agriculture that these groups are investing. We have to think about that. What are the implications for the goal of zero hunger as opposed to cash crops or other kinds of crops that might be of interest to groups that are coming in from other parts of the world into a continent like Africa? But there is no doubt that there is a huge focus on Africa as that next step of huge amounts of entrepreneurial investment where people feel that there's an opportunity to make a great deal of money. And I use that one to lead into my fifth and last one when it comes to the idea of zero hunger, of being able to not only increase the amount of production of food, but to make that available to people. Because the chart that you see in front of you shows the amount of imports just of agricultural products. So the idea being there that Africa is starting to pay out $80-100 billion of very important money that could be used in so many other investments for the importation of food. And that has caught the attention of the African Development Bank. This happens to be their big five investments. The president of the African Development Bank is a gentleman named Akin Adesina, who in fact, in case you might not know, received an honorary degree from our university last year. And what the vision of Dr. Adesina is to say that Africa has all of the elements to win, in his term, in agriculture, but really the goal of the African Development Bank and certainly Dr. Adesina's leadership is to bring down that amount of importation of foodstuffs from other parts of the world so that Africa can really be not only sustaining its own population, but starting to be, again, that opportunity for as an economic engine to start exporting these products as well. So what have I talked about? I've talked about the leadership that we're seeing within Africa to sort of lead into this area, the idea of new technologies that are very much coming on stream, the interest, excitement of young people coming back into agriculture and food across the continent, all of those issues around business as people really start to focus on Africa, and then this idea that without really moving forward on developing the agriculture and food sectors in Africa, there will continue to be this real weight of having to pay all of this money to import food. So I will leave it at that. I know that there aren't time for questions, but I mean, there are obviously so many other things that we could talk about. Where is this? Where are these activities happening in countries where there is safety, where there is security? Clearly, there are table stakes that are required to get some of these other things done. But I would say that it's a very optimistic time in Africa when you start to see business tycoons investing in agriculture, when there are these very clear ideas about how the kind of work that needs to get done, and all of these various groups working together. That's a very, very reassuring thing to me. It's an exciting place to work. Thank you very much.